Welcome to Beyond the Ball Podcast.
What's going on? What's going on? What's going on, ballers? And welcome to another episode of the Beyond the Ball Podcast. I'm your host, Jonathan Jones. And as you all know, or you might not know, but we managed to find just, you know, some really dope people around the world just doing some amazing things. In addition to that, the focus of the Beyond the Ball Podcast is stories, strategies, and successes, ultimately to help student athletes succeed beyond their degree. So if you have not just yet, I would encourage you all to make sure you subscribe on our YouTube channel so you can get all the episodes as well as some exclusive content. Okay, good deal. So now, without further ado, I want to go ahead and welcome this gentleman. I've seen him very active in these Twitter streets, and I know he's making a major impact way beyond that. So I'm glad just to have the conversation, get to have a dialogue with Coach Chadwick Hixon. And he is not only just a coach, but he's also an educator. In addition to that, he is a social justice advocate. Welcome to Beyond the Ball, Coach. How you doing?
I'm doing great. Thank you for having me.
Most definitely. Most definitely. Glad to have you. Glad to have you. Now, I'm gonna kick the rock to you. You know, two dribbles. And I'm gonna let you now just, you know, take a moment and introduce yourself, bait, for those who may or may not be familiar with your work as of yet.
Yeah, sure. My name is Chadwick Hixon. I'm based out of the Atlanta, Georgia area. Born and raised in the state of Georgia. You know, been here my entire life. As Jonathan spoke on earlier, I coach basketball, coach high school, as well as travel basketball. And just really try to use basketball as a teacher, you know, in a way to get kids to that next level in life. That's why I love this podcast, Beyond the Ball, you know, because we want to, you know, help our young people achieve both on and off the court or the field of play. So, you know, just really just try to do a lot of work with that, and a lot of rants on Twitter that I'm sure a lot of people see. But, you know, it's all, you know, from my heart and out of love for, you know, just trying to help people.
Yeah, yeah. So I guess we can start there. Since you took it there, I guess I'll take it there. So as I was just scrolling down your feed, you know, for one, you have a lot of content that I know that is really educational. It's like educational, inspirational. But even in addition to that, I see you really advocating for, you know, these young student athletes, even for some that, you know, might not get the press, might not get the fanfare. Just talk a little bit about how you decided to start using your platform in that way.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it's just coming from my own personal experiences. You know, as a student athlete, I was a pretty good high school player. I wouldn't say I was elite or anything like that, but I was pretty solid in high school and went on to play, you know, Division III in college at Emory University. And, I mean, we have enough people talking about the four and the five-star kids. There aren't enough people helping those kids who are kind of under the radar who might need some extra help. So, you know, just kind of leaning on my own personal experiences and know what I went through. That's kind of, you know, the reason why I've chosen to do the work that I do. It's really just trying to, you know, help kids avoid those same pitfalls and obstacles that I experienced when I was coming out of high school.
Yeah, yeah. Coach, take us back. Talk a little bit about your upbringing, and because I mean, just like you said, we're oftentimes exposed to, you know, the four star guys, the five star guys, people who, you know, that are getting the TV time and all that. But tell us about your journey. Take us back.
So I went to Bergmore High School. It's a public high school in Lilburn, Georgia. Traditionally a basketball powerhouse. They were state runner-up in class 7A last year. We weren't nearly that good when I was there, just to be honest. We were a little down. But again, you know, I played high school ball against you know, people like Lewis Williams that plays for the Hawks now. So you know, really, really, really high level competition, like a ton of talent, you know, in Gordon County during that time and even now as well. So again, it's just, you know, I was a good player, but obviously I wasn't, you know, good enough to go to the league straight out of high school. So, you know, not knowing any better, you know, I kind of didn't do the work that I needed to do to, you know, put myself in position to get to college. You know, examples of that I often talk about are, you know, just focus exclusively on getting a basketball scholarship. Like, I'm getting a basketball scholarship. Never thought, you know, okay, what's the plan if you don't get one? And, you know, was a decent student. I think I graduated with like a 3.2 GPA, you know, easily could have been a 3.5, 3.6 if I worked harder, you know, and that, you know, thousands of dollars, you know, kind of thrown down the drain because I didn't put forth that extra effort, you know, to do well academically. So, you know, I try to stay on kids, you know, especially the ones that are on my team, to, you know, really push them to do well academically because there's money in that. You know, an athletic scholarship is not the only way to pay for school. In fact, there are tons of other ways to pay for, you know, academics being a big one. So I really just pushed that because, you know, had I done those things, you know, maybe could have taken a different path. You know, I mean, things worked out in the end, but, you know, it's nice to have options. You know, I definitely would have had more options, you know, had I put forth the work in the classroom.
Yeah. I mean, I definitely could say the same thing because I also grew up in Georgia, and I was around that time with Lou Williams, but I was over at Wheeler. But
I know you went to Wheeler. OK.
Yeah, I wouldn't call myself elite either because I was not on that team. So, yeah. Wow. OK, so I'm curious to hear from you, Coach, because I know you coach on both sides. Right. So you coach with just with the young kids that are, you know, a part of the Atlanta Lightning. And then even in addition to that, then you're also, you know, you're also doing the high school coaching. Is it possible? Well, let me take a step back. Let me just leave you with that question. Can we just talk about the differences between those two teams and just talk about the differences, please?
Yeah. High school and travel ball are, you know, they're two different entities. I think they serve two different purposes, to be quite honest. From a travel ball perspective, you know, at least with the kids that I have, you know, we're trying to put them in position to, you know, be exposed to next level opportunities. So, you know, they have dreams of playing college basketball. You know, we try to put them in position to make that happen, you know, by playing in certain tournaments, playing on the right weekends, you know, when college coaches are going to be out. And also, you know, using my relationships and my contacts to, you know, connect them to schools that I feel like would be a good fit for them. High school, you know, some of the kids have those same aspirations. But I think, you know, the overall goal of high school athletics is to, you know, provide an opportunity for kids to, you know, learn like team building, those sorts of skills. Time management is a huge thing. You know, and also, you know, just kind of preparing them for life, you know, trying to extend the lessons from the classroom, you know, onto the basketball court is what we try to do.
Is it possible just from your experience and just from what you know, because I'm going to put you as the expert here because you are. So I've heard the conversation here and there. But do you think, how likely is it for a young student athlete for them not to play high school ball, but play travel ball and then see opportunity at the next level?
It's very possible now. I think in a lot of instances, the recruiting process is kind of kickstarted and kind of handled, you know, through travel basketball. And obviously college coaches, they want to see you with your high school team. And cause I mean, there's two different environments. You know, with travel basketball, there's not the scouting and the prep work. You know, you're not practicing 5-6 days a week. You know, you're just playing on the weekends. You know, you get in the game. You don't know who can shoot. You don't know who can do what. You know, versus high school where you know you've been looking at film, you know, all week. You know who does what and what their tendencies are and those sorts of things. So, I mean, there's definitely been kids who didn't play high school ball or weren't prominent, you know, on their team that have, you know, done well in travel basketball and gone on to play at the next level. I think that the NCAA is kind of trying to shift more power back to the high schools. I think that's why they implemented these June live periods where college coaches can come out and see kids with their high school teams. Mm-hmm. You know, we didn't have that before. It was, you know, it was just, yeah, the 2 weekends in April with AAU teams, and then you had 3 in July. There wasn't really, you know, any opportunities for them to do that in the summer, you know, with their high school teams.
Oh, okay. So is that why some of those, like, why some of those tournaments are so massive, or in previous years have been so massive, because everybody's coming out at the same tournaments around the same time?
Yeah, you know, they have those designated live period weekends. You know, we didn't have them last year in 2020 due to COVID, but and we didn't have them this spring in 2021 either. They, you know, as of June 1st, you know, the NCAA has kind of reopened things up. So in July, we're going to have three live period weekends, July 8th through 11th, the 16th through the 18th, and the 23rd through the 25th. So at those weekends, from an AAU perspective, college coaches will or Division I coaches will be able to go out and watch kids play. And when the D1s are able to go out, you know, everybody's going to be out. So there's going to be a ton of college coaches at these events. And many of them, you know, they haven't been out in a year and a half. So it's going to be really, really big in July. And from a high school perspective, like in Georgia, at least, you know, we have team camps next weekend, actually, the 18th to the 20th and the 25th to the 27th. So there'll be Division I coaches at those events as well.
Okay. So in your work, where do you see yourself long term? Like, I mean, because, you know, like as a kid, you know, when you're getting excited and get ready to play this team, you circle them on the calendar, you do all this stuff, you get ready for the game. But what are you circling on the calendar, like, for the future? Where does Coach Hixon want to end up?
Man, that's a really good question. I still kind of in the process of figuring that out. It took me a while to figure out what the basketball, you know, was, you know, truly a passion for me. You know, I played, obviously, from elementary school up through college, and then I kind of stepped away, honestly, for a little bit and started doing the coaching thing, and I've been hooked ever since. And, like, I love it. So that's why I do high school and AAU. Like, it's year round for me. I don't get a break. So it's gotta be something that I love and enjoy doing. So definitely want to remain coaching and working with young people. I would say one thing for me, like right now I coach 17U. So in a lot of instances, you know, I catch kids at the tail end of their high school career, and there's some things that in conversations that, you know, someone should have been having with them, you know, 2 or 3 years prior. And so I'd love to be in a position to have those conversations with them early on, so that when they do get to, you know, into junior year, senior year, they're better positioned to take that next step.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So let's say there's a high schooler out there listening. Let's say they're 15 years old. Let's say they're listening to me on the ball because they saw this episode was coming out with their favorite Coach Hixon. What would you say specifically to that young man or to that young woman, you know, as they're just getting ready to really start that journey with competing in basketball at a high level?
Yeah, the first thing I would say is, you know, focus on your academics, make sure your schoolwork is on point. And then also, explore your interests outside of, you know, basketball. You know, if you want to play another sport, play football, baseball, run track, do it. There's some student organization or club that you're interested in, do it. Volunteer at your church, do community service. Like, be well-rounded. Don't put all your eggs in that one basket. And you can be excellent in more than one area. You can be a great basketball player and, you know, be well-rounded. I mean, we've seen many, many, many examples of that. The one I always lean to is Myron Roll, who, you know, played football at Florida State, was a Rhodes Scholar. Like, mm-hmm. you can do these things. Like, you can be excellent in athletics and in academics and in extracurriculars. You don't have to, you know, just hold to one area.
Yeah, I think that's one of the things that's starting to come to the forefront now, right? Because I think it's two conflicting beliefs. Because I think initially it was do one thing, or this is the only way. Basketball is the only way. You're going to get here by playing a sport. And now, like, things are starting to open up because we're starting to see people like, and of course, this is at, you know, the highest level, because that's just where the most exposure and media attention is. But when we start seeing like the LeBrons filming a movie
right
in the middle of a season, and, you know, you see KD over here investing in technology, and just, you know, down the line, seeing Dwayne Wade now is, you know, up there in the owner's box with the Jazz. It's like, wait, what is going on? So I think, you know, this is a great, it's a great place for conversation to be had, for people to understand that you don't just have to be the athlete or the talent, but you can be somebody who's, you know, the manager, the coach, or all of these other different things that they now we can physically see people in these positions.
Absolutely. And basketball is the tool. Basketball is the vehicle that put them in that position to do those other things. So, I mean, you use basketball, I mean, or use athletics, you know, to put yourself in a better position to explore other things. But, no, what I hate to see is, I think this happens a ton, is you get to the end of your high school career or your college career, and the only thing you've ever done in your life is, you know, play that one sport. So then when it ends, it's like, okay, what now? Who am I? What do I like? What do I enjoy doing? You know, what other interests do I have? And it's not always easy. And like, so, and just to be quite honest, like, some of those coaches make it very difficult for kids to explore those interests at the high school and the college level. But the ones, in my opinion, the ones who are doing it the right way, you got to let your kids explore themselves. Like, I mean, what other time in their life are they going to have the opportunity to do so other than high school and college? So if you're truly about, you know, helping them, you know, better themselves, you know, on and off the field, you got to allow them those opportunities. And you can do that and still win. It's not easy, but it can certainly be done.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, just thinking back over some of the experiences I've had with certain coaches, and just remembering that there were some times where our coach would take us out for us to go bowling, or there were times where our coach would take us to maybe, you know, go on an out of town trip, depending on, you know, people's budgets and stuff like that. But understanding these are great opportunities for them to see exposure just to different things, different opportunities. But even outside of that, I'm a firm believer also of seeing the fact of that they're building these lifelong relationships with their teammates, and they're getting to know each other. And I really believe, in my opinion, I believe that, you know, when you have these type of relationships off the court, outside of the field, or, you know, whatever area you might be playing a sport, but this now really connects people deeper, so that when you step in those lines and when you're going to bat with your teammate, you don't have to worry, or are they going to cover you here or there? It's like, I mean, it's no shadow of a doubt. They got me taken care of.
Absolutely. Definitely agree with that.
Yeah, man. It's just and plus it makes great memories. Coach Hixon, it makes great memories, you know,
they're kids, like,
yeah.
And it is a game. Like, as much as we, I guess, don't focus on that, at the end of the day, it's a game that they're playing a sport, you know. It should be fun. They should get some enjoyment out of it. Now, that doesn't mean that you don't take it seriously and approach it, you know, business-like and be professional, but they still need to be able to have fun.
For sure. And one thing I want to chime on to what you said earlier, when you said at the end of it all, if the student athlete walks away and, you know, they're trying to figure it out, they don't know what to do. I pulled a tweet from your timeline, Coach. I used my Twitter finger and I pulled a tweet that you shared from John Thompson's book. And it said, you never want the sum total of your value to be the 8 or 9 pounds of air inside of a basketball.
Yeah, I'm reading that book right now. I Came as a Shadow. Yeah, man, when I saw that quote, I'm like, highlight, put in my little iPhone notes. Like, I need this. Like, this is my motto. It's my life. This is my life motto. This is why I coach.
Yeah, once I read it, and then once I thought about some of what we talked about earlier, I just saw the parallel between it, because I understand that you use basketball as a vehicle and a tool, because, I mean, that's what it is. But ultimately, the game of basketball can teach us a lot of things, but there are also a lot of things that the game of basketball cannot teach us. There are still a lot, but just seeing and understanding that if we continue to grow our overall development stock while we grow our basketball stock, then when it's time to cash in, either we're in a great position.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just, you know, reading the book, I mean, Coach Thompson, obviously he wanted to win. Like, he wouldn't have, you know, kept his job all those years if he didn't win, but, you know, he made education a priority. So, I can definitely identify with that. You know, and with the kids I work with, you know, the first step is, you know, let's just get to high school graduation, and then let's get to that next level. And whether it's getting an associate's degree, a bachelor's degree, or, you know, you're going into the military, you know, anything like that. Once you're doing, you know, positive, productive things, you know, once you get out into the real world. So, you know, whatever we can do to help them with that, that's the goal.
Most definitely. So when it's all said and done, when you're looking back over your life, how do you want to be remembered?
Just someone who genuinely worked as hard as he possibly could to help kids, and not just kids on my team, you know, kids in general. You know, whatever I can do to help young people is kind of what I'm focused on. And I do it through the lens of basketball and education. But, I mean, education is a broad term. You know, it doesn't necessarily mean everybody's going to get a 4-year degree. But we want to connect as many young people as possible to the information that's going to allow them to, you know, gain access to opportunities and ultimately, you know, be successful. So I guess someone who connected young people to opportunities.
That's solid. Now I have one more question for you before we get ready to dive into the 2-minute drill. Got one more. And if you had the opportunity to sit down with two people, alive or dead, there's no limits on who these two people could be. Who would you want these people to be sitting at your table, breaking bread, and, you know, you just being able to dive into conversation?
I mean, number one would be Malcolm X. Second, I'm gonna have to say Michael Jordan. I'm an MJ guy, so I gotta put MJ in there.
Okay, just elaborate a little bit on the why. I'm curious.
Malcolm X, just from the standpoint of his philosophies, his ideology, more so from a black empowerment standpoint, meaning encouraging us to own our own businesses, take control of our own destiny, support our own community, you know, those sorts of things. So, I didn't attend an HBCU, but I'm a big supporter of HBCUs. I'm a big supporter of, you know, Black-owned businesses, those sorts of things. I bank with Citizen Trust Bank, which is a Black-owned bank. So I'm all about that. And I think, you know, that message is a powerful one that was relevant, you know, 50 plus years ago, and still relevant now. As far as MJ, I mean, he's the GOAT. He's the greatest that's ever done it. I'd love to, you know, just sit down with him and, you know, talk to him about his work ethic, his approach to the game, his approach to business. And I know I'd also kind of like to pick his brain on you know, some of the criticism he's faced about his stance on social issues and those sorts of things, just to kind of get an idea of, you know, what he was thinking, you know, the reason why he did certain things. And I mean, he's the GOAT. So,
MJ or LeBron, Coach? MJ or LeBron?
Oh, MJ. MJ.
Question. What's your justification here?
Oh, I mean, I think the easy thing people go to is a 6-0, but for me, it's probably a little bit of a nostalgia, just to be quite honest. Growing up in the 1990s, watching, you know, Bulls games on WGN and just, you know, seeing him, you know, be dominant. Nobody will ever, you know, match him in my eyes.
Fair enough.
And there may not be any logic to it. I'm an MJ guy. Like, just that was, you know, my hero, my idol growing up as a basketball player.
That's fair.
I got LeBron in my top three. I got MJ, Kareem, and LeBron in the top three.
Ooh. Man, I don't even want to go down that path. especially when people start talking top 50 or top 10, it's like there's so many people that get left off the list. But, man.
Yeah, I mean, I'll give you a controversial thing. I don't have Kobe in my top 10.
Really? Man,
people get so mad when you say that. Like, really? Some people got him in their top five. I'm like, how do you got him in your top five? I can see top 10. Why? He's not in my top 10.
Why is he not in your top 10?
Let me see if I can do this off memory. I mean, I got MJ. This made no particular. I got MJ, Kareem, LeBron, Will Chamberlain, Bill Russell, Larry Bird, Magic Johnson, Tim Duncan, Shaq, and Hakeem Olajuwon.
See, that's what it is. It's just so tough because this is that barbershop conversation.
Yeah.
Because when people pick their top 10, you know, there's some preference in there. Of course, all of them have the stats, but it just depends on what part of the country you're in, where you grew up, and then who you just really rock with ultimately. But that's when you grew up,
because I mean, you see a lot of the older players, like they won't put, you know, Jordan or LeBron in their top five. Just because, you know, they're trying to show love to their specific era.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Which is fine. I mean, I didn't see Will Chamberlain play. So, I mean, he's great, obviously. But, I mean, I never saw him play, obviously.
Fair enough. Yeah, fair enough. Man, okay. I think this was actually the first time I ever had that even part of an MJ LeBron conversation on this podcast. So, congratulations, Coach. This is the first time. Oh, man. But we're going to go ahead and dive into the two-minute drill, Coach. And for those of you who might not know, the two-minute drill is just where we have some rapid-fire questions. We have a little bit of fun. And then we go ahead and get ready to wrap this thing up. So, Coach Hixon, are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. Here we go. Favorite food?
Chicken Parmesan.
Okay. What's the last book you read?
The Years That Matter by Paul Tough.
Okay. What's the most underrated cereal?
Underrated Lucky Charms.
Ooh, yes, sir. Yes, sir. What's your go-to streaming show of preference?
Game of Thrones.
Okay. And then what?
Seasons 1 through 7. We don't acknowledge season 8.
And then what's one tip that you want to share with a student athlete? You can take your time.
Ask for help. Use your resources. I talked to so many young people, and one of the first questions I asked them is, when's the last time you met with your guidance counselor? And in many instances, they've never, you know, spoken to their guidance counselor. So, you know, as an incoming freshman, you need to establish that relationship. Especially if you want to, you know, play collegiate sports, because you got to do all your eligibility center stuff, and the earlier you get, you know, all those things situated, talk with your counselor. He or she should be able to talk to you about the classes you need to take, those sorts of things. So get that conversation started early, you know, as a freshman. Don't wait until, you know, second semester of your senior year to meet your guidance counselor.
There it is. And one bonus question: who would you like to see me interview on Beyond the Ball next?
Have you spoken to my guy William Payne?
Man, I reached out to Coach P. Me and Coach P. We're definitely due for a follow up conversation. Okay. We're definitely due for a follow up conversation.
He would be the one that I would recommend.
Okay, there it is. Coach Hixon, just let everybody know where they can find you and follow you and connect with you, please, sir.
Yeah, so I'm on Twitter all the time. At Coach Hixon Dimes, so at CoachHixonDimes. I'm sure you'll see my rants on your timeline. Definitely feel free to reach out if you have any questions or need help with anything.
There it is. Well, Coach Hixon, I appreciate you taking the time to grace the Beyond the Ball virtual podcast stage. So thank you, sir.
Appreciate you. Thank you for having me.
Most definitely. To all the ballers out there, you all heard Coach Hixon. Definitely take time and connect with him at Coach Hixon Dimes, just as he said. Be sure to connect with him because he puts out great content on his feed, in addition to also having some funny rants, just as he shared. But if you're not subscribed, once again, be sure to subscribe to the Beyond the Ball podcast, wherever you listen to podcasts, but especially on YouTube. But without further ado, and we're going to go ahead and just get out of here. I'm Jonathan Jones, and this is Beyond the Ball, where we help you succeed beyond your degree.